Historically, you know, in the early days of me being in Sheffield, it was political. I think there was another political element going on for me in almost like a totally different way. And that was me coming out. And if that's, Steve and I talk about this, that's a political statement in and of its own right, I think. And back in the 80s, Britain was not a friendly place to gay people. So coming out was a huge step and actually occupied a good couple of years of my life. And I remember coming out, first May bank holiday in 1988, going into the Cossack pub and meeting people there who were just lovely to me. And so began a bit of a journey, really, of understanding what it meant to be a gay man, spending time with other gay people for the first time in my life and actually using the terminology for myself.
So I grew up with that sense of being gay was something really bad and really awful, and in many ways confused me around my sexuality. So I, you know, thought I was probably heterosexual when I got married and I had children, and then subsequently met Mark, and sort of my politics and my sort of sexuality all sort of coalesced at the same time, really. So I came out sort of as gay, sort of, and that was also quite a political thing for me. I was a social worker during the HIV crisis and got involved in HIV and became an HIV social worker, supporting people living with HIV, and then became very much involved in sexual health and young people's sexual health and HIV and HIV campaigning. And then in the last few years, I've been running an LGBT plus charity here in Sheffield. I guess my discovery of Carpenter was a bit of a journey, really. So I think if I start from growing up in the Midlands, where there were no role models, and the idea was almost like this is being gay or being bisexual or being lesbian or whatever, you know, was a new thing. Was quite rife and still is with some people, that it's a modern sort of choice that people make. So there's never a role model or a historical role model that I could call upon.
I think I identified myself and my desire for that kind of compassionate world in the themes that he chose to do work on. Whether it was, you know, forming trade unions, or my granddad was a staunch trade unionist. My grandmother, bless her, was deaf, and she used to lip read Margaret Thatcher and swear back at the television. And they're incredible kind of socialist and believed in protecting working people. And I mean, absolutely committed to it. So there were some themes, I think, that I connected with straight away through my own family experience and through my own desire for that kind of compassionate, kinder world, really.
He fought for gay rights, but he fought for women's rights. He fought for the rights of working class people, for the poor. And it's that holistic sort of fight that I really believe in. And that's why Carpenter speaks to me, really.
What we're driven by in Friends of Edward Carpenter is, here you go, world. Take note, this person was around. And I'd be really surprised if this person doesn't have something to say about the things you care about.